Okay, I was going to show how I installed this mini split step by step. But there's a lot of great videos out there that you could certainly take a look at and learn from. So I decided not to take the time. I was kind of in a hurry anyway to get it put together and what have you. But it really came out nice. So as you can see, I went ahead and did the wall bracket for it. Now, be sure, and I think they're incredibly easier if you get the bracket with the cross member, the horizontal cross member, instead of just the vertical pieces. It just makes installing and positioning and everything just way easier, I think. This is the 21 SEER model and 9000 BTU, just a single zone. You can see I went ahead and did the line hide up there to the into the house. Now this particular one I just bought off of Amazon. It was a little cheaper than the one that Pioneer sold, and any other place that I could find. This was cheapest on Amazon, so I'll leave a link for that down in the description below. I'll also obviously leave a link to this unit. Certainly your needs and size will vary. They have less efficient models like 19 SEER that are a couple hundred dollars less. This one performs extra well in the cold, in heating mode. Do your research and figure out what you need. And I'll show you some of the tools I used to do this installation, because this is not a DIY type unit. And I'm also going to give you a tip here as well. When it comes to installing these, there's a great resource to be able to get EPA certified so that you can, handle refrigerants and what have you. So if you're willing to invest a little bit of time in education to be able to get your certification so that you can handle these refrigerants, that would certainly be worth looking into. That's what I did. I went through the process, got EPA certified, and then I also tested out of HVAC tech school, so got that certification as well. My line sits a little longer than 25 feet, so I was able to purchase and add the additional refrigerant I needed to with that certification. Now let's take you inside and show you that. Here's the indoor unit. Just kind of conditions this little attic room. Clean, simple, nice. No fuss. It's just nice, this unit. I love it. I'm gonna throw up here on the screen some pictures of the temperature readings I got when this was running in cool, as well as when it was running in heat. So you can kind of see what kind of conditioning this does for the room. And it's pretty impressive. I'm thrilled with how it all came together. It's working flawlessly, no complaints. So anyway, leave a link for some Pioneer mini splits down in the description so you can check some of those out. I think the quality that you get for the price you pay is hard to beat. Certainly there's fancier units out there, more efficient potentially, but a lot of those, are maybe not quite so advanced DIY as these are, and so I think these certainly demand some time and attention from you. Okay guys, these are the tools that I use to install the mini split air conditioner. They work extremely well. Now let me just insert here. I'm a little bit more advanced than your average DIY guy when it comes to HVAC, okay? I graduated from HVAC tech school. I'm EPA certified, all that good stuff. I just happen to not work in the field, but I know a thing or two about HVAC. So just putting that out there as you see some of this stuff. As far as, tools go, these are some of the best that you can get. Let's start over here on the right, and we'll work our way over. So I've got just a reaming tool there, just to be able to do my own flares. And then I got the NAVAC NTF66C flaring tool. Now, this thing is awesome. One of my favorite features is this right here. I'm going to cut to a video here of me using that and explaining what I like about that.
Just a quick plug for this flaring tool that I've got. One of my favorite features about it, aside from, you know, just how high quality and nice it is this little tab right here that slides. That is a depth gauge, okay? So it stops your pipe from coming out too far and gives it a positive stop so that you get pretty much perfect flares, size flares, every single time. And I just absolutely love that. So let's see if I can do this one-handed. Bear with me for a second here. If I put my little piece here in the tool, okay, and then you slide this over, then you're able to push the copper up until it touches. See, like that, and you can see the copper's just sticking up a hair. But that that gives us a positive stop, and then obviously you move that out of the way before you flare it. But it works really good. I still haven't deburred inside this or anything, so ignore that. Just showing you how the depth control works on that. That's a lifesaver. That way you don't have to, you know, trial and error, figure out, you know, what, you know, how deep to put it in, how far out it should stick, you know, get too big, too small. You know, you just get it perfect every time.
Okay, so as you saw on that, it's just a lifesaver to have that depth gauge. This makes incredible flares. Let me show you a sample here. So this is a factory flare that came on the line set. It's not a bad flare. I've actually seen worse, but it's not, you know, just bonkers amazing. Can you see that little lip down in there? They've like folded the copper over on itself and then flared it. To me, it doesn't seem like it might not sit quite as tight and nicely as a normal flare. So anyway, I didn't use any of the factory flares. I did my own flares. And here's a flare that flaring tool did. And that's with the depth gauge and everything. And as you can see, it's just smooth and nice and clean. Slightly dirty because I had a little bit of nylog on my flaring tool, and I forgot to wipe it off before I did this. So anyway, it's got a little bit of dirt on there, but for the sake of looking at the flare, it is a really nice flare. So anyway, that tool is the bomb. I love it. So that's what I use to flare all my connections. And then my line set was a little longer than 25 feet. So I ended up needing to add a little bit of refrigerant, which I can do because I am EPA certified, able to purchase and you know, handle that. So not everyone can do that. It is a fairly easy process, though, to get EPA certified. There's a lot of great online resources and stuff. Maybe I'll link one down below that a lot of people have had great success with that I used a little while ago, and it worked out really great. So I'll leave the link for them down in the description below. And then here I've got my refrigerant manifold. This also has a micron gauge built in. It works pretty good. I do like having a separate micron gauge just because you can see a little better. Sometimes the hoses leak a little bit. I have not sprung for that yet. I've just been using this gauge with the micron gauge built into it. It works pretty good with the correct hoses, and I'll show you which ones those are here in just a second. But highly recommend that. It comes with the little temperature clamps. So you know, you can measure superheat and subcooling and etc. You know, on other units, not so much on a mini split. Over here is the vacuum pump I use. I just have the 6 CFM model, the VP67. That's plenty big and plenty fast enough for my needs, but they do make the larger ones as well. Up here, I've got my multimeter. I love this thing. I use this more than any of these other tools put together. The SC640. The thing that's nice about it is it does all the stuff. It's got the clamp, it's got the probes. It comes with little alligator clip options as well. But it also has the thermocouple. So you can take temperature readings really easily with it. You know, maybe you've got your gauges hooked up and they can handle the outside temperatures, but you might need to, you know, read the inside temperature. And this works really good without needing to get, you know, additional temperature probes or anything. So that's a really nice feature about this particular meter. And then in this box here, I've got some nice hoses. So I've got 2 3/8 vacuum hoses, vacuum rated hoses right here. Those are what I use to pull my vacuum. And then I've got some charging hoses down there. All of this stuff is available for purchase at True Tech Tools. They're not sponsoring this video, nor is Field Piece or anyone else. I'm just a guy who likes high quality tools and likes to do the job right. Anyway, I'll leave a link down in the description to True Tech Tools so you can check them out. They treat you well, reasonably fast shipping, best prices that I've found around here at least. So anyway, hopefully seeing some of these tools is helpful to know, you know, what I used and how I installed this latest mini split. Okay, two last critical pieces of equipment that I think are 100% necessary when you're doing an installation of a mini split. This nylog right here is absolutely a must, I think, for the flares. My tool makes beautiful flares, and I think they would certainly hold, but I've never ever had, knock on wood, right, any flares that have leaked when I've used this, even after numerous years. So I think it's definitely worth the investment. A little goes a long way, it lasts a long time, so I would certainly encourage you to use nylog when you're doing your flares, okay? And then last but not least, we've got a valve core removal tool. This one is specific for mini splits because it has the 5/16 end here instead of the 1/4 inch, which you need. So the nice thing about this is it doubles as the adapter that you need to go from, you know, your standard refrigerant hoses to, or vacuum hoses to the mini split. And then you're able to remove the valve core with this. That way you are able to remove that restriction and you're able to pull a vacuum insanely fast. Perhaps even more important is you're able to get the unit off this piece right here without a big poof of refrigerant. You know, you'll see on a lot of videos where people are unscrewing their fitting, and as they're unscrewing it, the core is still depressed and there's a big cloud of refrigerant as it escapes, which is bad for the environment and is bad for your hands, and you lose some charge from your mini split. So when you go to remove this from the valve core, what you're able to do is, you know, you use this, stick it back in, reseat it, then, you know, take it off. And then I like to shut this off because this valve will seal it off, right? And I take this off again, and then you just slowly crack this to make sure that that core did seat, right? And if it did, you might hear a slight little hiss, and then you're able to just unscrew it. So it makes removing the tool from that valve core significantly easier with under pressure, and reduces release of any kind of refrigerant, any large quantity. So anyway, I really like this, and makes the job a whole lot easier. And those valve cores tend to leak over time, so being able to have a tool to be able to replace those as needed makes a huge difference as well. So I love this tool, and I think it's definitely a good thing to have in the arsenal to do kind of more of a pro style DIY installation of a mini split. Kind of a overall view of these different tools that I use to install this mini split. And a good way for you to level up your DIY skills to go from DIY to more of a pro DIYer. So anyway, links for where to get these things are down below. And if you like these kinds of videos, don't forget to like and subscribe. Leave a comment down below any questions you may have about any of these things or the mini split installation. I'd love to help answer any and all of those. So we'll catch you next time.